Hello, I'm Zeinab Badawi. Welcome to the magnificent concert hall here in Stockholm, where this year's Nobel Prize winners received their awards from the King of Sweden. This is the first time that they have come together on television, and they're joined here in the audience by their family and friends, as well as students from all over Sweden. We'll be asking them if the best kind of science is useful science. Welcome to Nobel Minds. And this year, we have discoveries that help with our everyday lives, that bring light to poorer communities and reduce energy costs, that tell us how we know where we are and where we are going. The Chemistry Prize is about seeing. Now, for the first time, we have microscopes that can see molecules. And the Economics Prize helps tell us how we can better structure markets to benefit the consumer and society. So that's the work of our Nobel Laureates here. Congratulations and welcome to you all. Okay, so before we talk about your various activities and so on, I want to know how you all found out that you had become this year's Nobel Prize winners. And it is wonderful to have a rare species with us today, a female scientist who has won the Nobel Prize. You won it in medicine or physiology, my Brit from Norway. So just tell us, how did you find out?
No, so I was it was a beautiful Monday morning, and we had a lab discussion, presentation of some data. And I was so excited by these data. And then I got this annoying phone call. And it was a number that I didn't recognize. And I just know, I normally don't answer phones that I don't know the number of. And then I suddenly got this female intuition. Behave. Mm-hmm. Answer the phone.
Your reaction went viral.
When
you realised why you'd won. You mm-hmm. started dancing, didn't you, my Brit?
Yeah.
Can you show us
yeah.
what you did? What did you do?
So I was woo!
Hang on, do it one more time. Yeah. So we have the dancing Nobel Prize laureate here, who danced for joy when she heard she got it. Edward, my Brit is your wife, of course. You're a couple, both, and also your colleague, Professor John O'Keefe, who is not with us. You were given the prize in medicine or physiology, but you were on an aeroplane, I understand.
That's right. So I actually got to know it after everyone else. I landed at Munich Airport. I was going to the Max Planck Institute, and then I was met by a woman, a representative from the airport, that picked me up, and I asked, why did you come to the gate of the plane? And she told me that I won a prize, and I didn't take it. And then she said it was a prize for from the Max Planck Society, so she mixed it up. So, and then finally I started checking my phone, and then hundreds of messages, and then one from Göran Hansson.
But not your wife? Not your wife?
No, she was not there yet. And he said, it's important, call me back, and then I...
So that's how you found out. Okay, and Stefan Hell, so you were... I think you were accessible, weren't you?
Yes, actually I had a project discussion with a postdoc because we have seen something new and exciting with our sharp light microscope.
You're one of the chemist laureates,
right,
I should say, yeah.
Right, and actually I wanted to know whether this has been seen somewhere else. And I pulled down a paper where I felt that it could be perhaps mentioned there or not, and I wanted to study the paper to see what was known and if that is totally new what we've seen. And it turned out to be new.
So, and the phone rang
and
when you were
phone
told?
Rang, the phone rang, and I was surprised, what's going on?
But you
on?
Didn't dance?
I didn't
You
answer.
Didn't dance, okay. All right, and your fellow chemist laureate here, Eric Betzig, I think you were also at a conference in Germany,
I was,
you?
In Munich.
So how did you find out?
Well, I think there's somebody here who can speak to that question better than I can.
Really?
Yes.
Who's that?
That would be my son, Ravi. He's 15 years old.
Oh, so where's Ravi? Oh, Ravi, you got a house. So, hello, everybody. This is Ravi Betzig. So what happened?
So keep in mind that unlike the others, my father and I live in the States. So the announcement is very, very early in the morning, our time, 5:30 a.m. And I had woken up early to do some work and the phone rings. I'm thinking, who on earth is calling this early in the morning? But I pick it up and they say, it's a secretary. And I say, hello. And she says, yes, is Dr. Betzig there? And I say, yes, ma'am, I'm Dr. Betzig. And she's a little bit skeptical, but she transfers the line to an older sounding man. He says, sir, Dr. Betzig, congratulations on winning the Nobel Prize in Chemistry along with your colleague Stefan Helen W. Mourner. And I said, sir, sir, yes? I'm actually not Dr. Betzig. Dr. Betzig is my father. He's currently on business in Germany, and here's his mobile number if you want to contact him there.
That's amazing. But I've got one question for you, Ravi, is what were you doing awake at 5:30 in the morning?
Some schoolwork I wanted to finish.
Ah, right, OK, that explains it. Wow. Oh, well, thank you very much. And so that's how you found out, then. They called you on your mobile phone, but...
Yes, but you can see I have a prize that's much more valuable than a Nobel.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. One of your four children, I think, is that right? Yeah. Right. And Professor W.E. Mourner, so what were you up to?
I was in Brazil. I had a conference, a scientific conference, getting dressed, ready to go to the meeting, and the first thing that happened was a text from my wife. It says, turn on your phone. Of course, my phone didn't really work there. So anyway, she had gotten contacted first by the Associated Press and called me.
So you knew it wasn't a prank call. OK, so two of the three Nobel Prize winners in physics, because your colleague, Professor Akasaki, again, is not with us. Professor Nakamura, so yeah. I think you live in California because you're at the University of Santa Barbara, so it must have been an unearthly hour for you when you were told.
Yes. Yeah, so basically, you know, I got the phone call at 2 p.m. So 2 a.m. So 2 a.m. is I was sleeping, you know, so, but... So, but one day before, I know my colleagues told me, you know, you have to put the cell phone on. Maybe there are possibility, you know.
Oh.
So I left my cell phone next to my bed, and at 2 a.m. another ceremony.
So you were kind of forewarned. So it wasn't a huge surprise for you. Well, what about your colleague here, Professor Amano?
Yeah, in my case, I was in the plane from Nagoya, Japan, to transit to Frankfurt. And I saw many, many email that entitled congratulations. Congratulations, congratulations.
but
I didn't understand what the congratulations means. So I moved to the final destination to France, Lyon, and found many journalists came the exit of arrival hall. And finally, I found it.
So you were actually in Lyon in France by then,
right.
Where you found out. So that's it. And Professor Jean Tirole, you are the sole winner of the Nobel Prize in Economics this year. Now, I think you missed the initial call, didn't you, because your phone was on vibrate. Were you working on some great new theory?
Actually, not. I was working on a European Research Council grant with a collaborator.
How mundane.
Yes, that's very mundane. We also have to get money, we scientists. And like my Brit, I didn't want to be bothered, so I put my phone on vibrating mode. So they kept calling and calling and calling. And then I finally heard the phone vibrating, and I looked at it, and I saw 46, 46, what is this? Oh, 46 is Sweden, what's going on? So I took it, and you get it, and you wonder, is that a joke? And, you know, it was not a joke.
No, clearly it's not a joke because you're here now. Well, let's carry on with you, Professor Tirole, because you were given the Nobel Prize basically for various theories that all come under one umbrella, as it were, of how to structure markets, regulate them, regulate big business and so on, to better benefit the consumer. And I know that when you were given your ceremony, I was listening to the citation, they sort of compared your theories to a baker, how a baker selling bad bread and has no competition is going to carry on selling the bad bread rather expensively. And your theory helps tell us how we can tackle that kind of market abuse.
Well, that's right. There's always danger that firms which are non-competitive can raise price or offer low quality. So you have to work through it in two different ways. One is antitrust, a competition policy. You intervene to avoid abuses of dominant position or bad mergers, which will raise price and lower quality. Or you can regulate directly telecoms and electricity and banks and the like. So our work has been to apply game theory and information economics to that kind of situation so as to provide theories and empirical work that could help those authorities to deal with big firms.
And can you see now areas where we have monopolies or oligopolies where they are kind of crowding out competition and they themselves perhaps are a bit inefficient and give expensive products for the consumer? Do you think that's quite a common problem in the world now?
It's a common problem. It has always been. I mean, with telecoms and electricity and railroads, there are what we call essential facilities or bottlenecks, which are extremely costly to reproduce. So you have natural monopolies and you have to give access to create competition. So part of our work was to think about how to create access to those bottlenecks. But you also have, in all those high-tech industries, you have like Google and Microsoft, and there are large fixed costs of, for example, building a search engine, or there are large network sites because there are lots of apps and people want to interoperate. And so in the end, you tend to have monopolies at some point of time. But the important thing is that new firms which are more efficient can enter to replace those monopolies if needed.
I want to go to the audience here because we've got a couple of questions from economics students. We have one here. Just say your name briefly and then put your question, please. Yes,
Maria, I wanted to ask, what do you think it is more effective to regulate large entities like Spain or the United Kingdom, or maybe smaller ones like Catalonia and Scotland?
Okay, before you answer that, let's just see if there's any other question. Young lady behind you, just give us your name.
My name is Gail. You authored that your work don't have to be influenced by your political ideas, but as economics and politics are quite related, what are your recommendations for future economists to remain as much as possible political neutral?
Okay, Thanks. Do you want to answer that first of all? Is regulation easier when it's for... Because, I mean, that's it. You know, you can't just regulate parts of the financial institutions. Globalization means you need a global regulatory framework.
I think Maria's question is a very important one. For one thing, lots of those firms now, like the banks, are actually multinationals, so we have to regulate at a broader level. So in Europe, for example, you have the banking union, which tries to actually regulate at the ECB level, at the European Central Bank level. And antitrust authorities also try to cooperate more and more with each other because it's hard. You know, Google is a worldwide enterprise, of course. So that's an important thing. And you know, climate change also is an obvious thing that you have to regulate at the world level. Regulated at the country level is not going to help because then the pollution is going to migrate somewhere else. So you need a world agreement for that.
Again, in your citation, they said that you don't shy away from the politics, and I know that you've been quoted in the press giving advice to the French government about its massive deficit and telling them that they have to reform or die and so on. So you don't shirk the political area, do you?
Well, I try to be neutral in the sense that I never comment on politicians and politics or, you know, support a candidate or anything like that. I think it's very important because otherwise you are linked to a party or to some ideas and basically discredited because they will say, you know, you are saying that not because of your science, but because you have those political leanings. So actually when I got the prize, all the journalists wanted to know for whom I voted, and nobody was able to say. And also they wanted to know whether I was a pro-market or an anti-market person, and they were unable to say. And the reason, you know, is that I just say what my science says. And you know, whether I like it or not, I just go for it. And you know, and then journalists extrapolate, of course. You know, they say, you know, they try to say it's in support of this kind of this person or this party, and that I dislike
quite
a lot.
So not party political, so you are kind of unbiased and you stick to your science. But you do have very strong political opinions. For instance, you've been quoted as saying that you think the euro is a flawed currency and you believe in what could loosely be described as a EU superstate. You're a big federalist.
I'm a big federalist, yes, that's right. I mean, the Eurozone institutions are a little bit weak, so it's a currency union, but at the same time, you don't have the institutions which goes with a currency union like the US, for example. The US has a currency union, but also has a common budget, has common laws. And we don't have that in Europe, and I would like to have that in Europe as well. Now, it's a bit difficult to do right now because there is such a difference between Northern Europe and Southern Europe that it's, we should have done that earlier, of course. Mm-hmm. But hopefully that will come.
But you say you're a big federalist, but I mean, you know, you look around European countries at the moment, and you know, in the Front National in France did very well at the European parliamentary elections. We have the UK Independence Party in the United Kingdom. Your opinions perhaps are slightly going against the tide of public opinion in Europe?
Well, I'm afraid so. I mean, it's true that, I mean, here in Sweden, you see what's happening, and it's happening almost in every country in Europe where you really have xenophobic countries and parties, and it's very hard to understand. I mean, we should understand where history is leading you, is leading us, and people just don't learn. And also, they have very bad economics, and all those parties, those extremist parties, have terrible economics, but people don't realize that.
Edward, let's turn to what you did. It was divided into two, the prize, between your work and Professor O'Keefe's. And since he's not here, just to sort of really paraphrase, that he identified what are known as place cells, working with rats, which kind of tells us about the workings of the inner GPS in our brains that tell us how we know where we are and where we're going and how we store that information so we can use it for the next time. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so tell us more about why his discovery was so significant. You, my Brit.
You listen to the small electrical pulses in the brain cells, because they talk by sending electrical pulses. And one such pulse you can magnify so that it's 10,000, 20,000 or more in amplitude. And then you can listen to it. And then a place cell would be silence, silence, silence. Boop, boop, boop. And whenever the rat is coming back to a certain place in the environment, you hear the same popcorn sound, like a popcorn bag in a microwave oven. And it's such a beautiful sound for us.
And we've got about 500,000 to 1 million place cells in our brains, in the hippocampus.
At least in the rat brain, yeah.
Yeah, which is what, somewhere near the temples, is that right?
Yeah, just
somewhere there. Yeah. You identified a separate set of nerve cells involved in navigation, which are activated when a rat passes certain locations, hence the grid cells. So just you tell us about those.
Yeah, so the difference is that the place cells that O'Keefe discovered, they are usually active at one location. The cells that we discovered, we call them grid cells because they are active at many locations, and those many locations form a grid, a very, very periodic map of the environment. So it's almost like a coordinate system where you have crossing points that are at regular distances.
Mm, sure. And since we're talking about useful science, this discovery helping us understand how the brain works, but we know in illnesses like brain diseases like Alzheimer's that a sense of space and where you're going is one of the first things to go. So what kind of application might your discovery help Alzheimer's and other mental
brain diseases? Yeah, I would like to say two things about that. First of all, that area that contains those cells, that's usually the first one to be affected in Alzheimer's disease, and you get problems with navigation and so on. But so it's very important for Alzheimer's. But I would also say that it's perhaps even more important because it allows us to understand the basic principles of how the brain works. So these cells are so easy to measure. It's actually provide a window into the working principles of the brain. And I think this is basic research. We understand how the brain works. And then in the future, I can guarantee we'll also understand other diseases because we get to the fundamental principles of the brain.
Like what other diseases?
Schizophrenia, depression, anxiety disorders, the whole spectrum, because they all depend on some rather small number of working principles that is used by the brain.
Mm. Wonderful. Let's hope that happens.
The brain is us.
Yes.
And the interesting thing is what Edward said here, that if you have a window and you can put a window, just remove part of the skull and put a window and use these guys' microscopes and just look.
We'll come to these guys'
cells.
Microscopes in a moment. Let's go to the audience. Who's got a question for the Morses, this dynamic duo?
Obviously, the two of you working together was very successful, but maybe you can tell us a little bit more. How is it if your partner, your colleague at work, is at the same time your wife or husband, if you see each other all the time?
I can tell you one thing. At least I don't have to sit home and then get the critics. Why isn't the dinner finished?
But, my Brit, you are, as I said, a rare species, because there are very few women...
I'm not women. Rare. How many women do
I have? At this table. Since I'm with scientists, I will use more exact scientific, precise language. You are the only female amongst these Nobel laureates.
That's true.
And I often sit around this table when I've done this program in the past, and there are no female science laureates. So I have to ask you, why is it that, you know, particularly at the top of the pyramid in the scientific community and academic institutions, there are very few My Brit Mursas, even in your own country, Norway?
No, so that's not part of my background in science. So I have to just speculate. And of course, when you need to, when you get such a prize, you are sort of top of a pyramid. And in order to come to that pyramid, you need a pool. And the pool you need is a lot of women here, and then it's become sharper and sharper. To the top. So it's just about, we need to get more women interested, and also more women who can trust themselves, so that they think, yes, I'm good enough to win a Nobel Prize, why not? But to be in science, you have to work a lot, you have to travel a lot, and especially a mom, and here is, I might be biased, but especially a mom doesn't want to leave her children.
Because you've been to conferences when you're... And girls were very small.
Yeah, and leaving a baby while you are breastfeeding, you don't do that. It's painful. I've tried it once. Never, ever again.
Any other comments from here? Eric Betzig?
My wife and I met at Genelia. She's a neuroscientist, and same thing is that two heads are, even though she's in a different field than I am, you know, two heads are better than one. There's sort of common principles that we can help each other out at work. And we can help with the child rearing and tag team, take off, you know, time as necessary for the kids. Mm. But one thing we don't do is no pillow talk about science. Once we get home, science is...
Really?
We'll talk.
It's who's put the rubbish out and that kind of conversation.
We want a stress-free environment.
Professor Myrna, your views on this?
What I see happening is some improvements in these numbers over time. I bet if you looked at those numbers 10 years ago, you see that they're better now, because some of these new policies that are being put in place to help with child rearing, that are help with sort of alternative ways of helping across this barrier. So we're working hard on it. We're working very hard to get more women in at high levels of the professorate in the United States.
Stefan Hell, briefly.
I think it improved, definitely in Germany. I think the number of female students in physics and chemistry has gone up substantially. So when I started, out of 100 students, maybe two or three were women. Now it's 20.
Your Chancellor Angela Merkel is a scientist.
Yes, actually.
Isn't she? You think they've
wonderful.
Got a role model there? Yes. And she worked as a scientist too, didn't she? She didn't just study it. Yes.
That's correct.
What about the experience in Japan, women scientists in Japan? How do they do?
Yeah, in terms of the statistics, we are still in the development. Only 8% of the full professor is women in my university, in our university. It's a national university, so one of the top level university, but still.
Only 8% women. Of professors are women in Nagoya University, where you are.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. So let's turn to the chemist laureates. So you basically, working independently, came up with a solution to make microscopes work much better, so that now for the first time we can look inside cells to see molecules. Mm-hmm. But how did you do that? Because, I mean, microscopes have been around for ages.
The prize recognizes a super resolution fluorescence microscopy. And some people may not know what this fluorescence business is. So I can illustrate it a little bit and give you a few of the key ideas. Here's a liquid. There are a lot of molecules in this vial, maybe 10 to the 24th. That's one with 24 zeros after it. But inside this, we also have some fluorescent molecules. And we want to be able to see these molecules. So let me just illustrate the idea. I have a green laser here, a green laser pointer that's green, very green. But when I shine it through this solution, the fluorescent molecules inside give you a more of a yellowish color. Mm. And you can see that I can, just like a lightsaber, only where the beam is going, it's hitting the molecules, and the molecules are sending light back. That's what we mean by fluorescence. And so what we are doing in these microscopes is using lasers, and this property I just showed, that the molecules themselves emit light back, like little tiny light sources. And it's because 25 years ago, one of the ways to achieve super resolution relies on being able to see single molecules. That's what I worked on. And you can actually now, with your eyes, look into a microscope and see the light coming from individual molecules.
So, Eric, I mean, the chemistry prize, you know, was awarded because it's about seeing. But what does this seeing actually do? What kind of diseases might it help us?
I always feel uncomfortable when media tries to project us into applications of technologies. It will have applications, but it's very difficult to predict. That's one of the things with technology in general, is it's very difficult to predict what the ultimate ultimate benefits will be.
Are you willing to predict, Stefan?
Yeah, I'm
he's willing to predict. All right. Thank you.
He can send the question to us.
Okay, we'll ask you in a minute, yeah.
I mean, we have used the high resolution in order to find out key processes going on, for example, in HIV. So virology, I'm quite confident, will be strongly impacted by the microscopes that we have invented. Mm.
Professor Myrna, do you feel queasy about answering what kind of future applications?
Well, the real point is you see in much greater detail than what you saw before, and you see surprises. You see things that weren't necessarily expected. And all of these super-resolution methods are something like recognizing that the cell is something like a little city where there are many molecules, proteins that are moving around, little motors, and DNA and RNA and so forth. But if you only look at it very, very high up in the sky where it's only fuzzy, you don't see what's going on. The super-resolution lets you see far more clearly, that is a factor 5, 10, or more better already. And the point is, then you see surprises, things that we didn't understand about the cell biology.
Mm. You've benefited from these guys' discoveries, haven't you?
In general, yes, the advances in microscopy, and especially the advances that allow microscopes, fluorescence microscopes, to be used in living animals. So the resolution that the three laureates have worked on today, it's even beyond what we can use at the moment, but I think this will come. Mm.
Professors Amano and Professor Nakamura, along with Professor Akasaki, you were all awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics for your blue light emitting diode, which made possible a highly efficient light source that's now replacing the incandescent light bulb that Thomas Edison gave us. So we've had red, green emitting diodes for what, about 50 years, and your blue one has been around for about 20 years. You combine the blue with the red and the green, and perhaps you can show us what happens, Professor Nakamura.
Yeah, basically, without blue light, you cannot make white. Big advantage of the LED lighting is a point light source, so we can use lens to make any kind of shape of the light. For example, this is circle, no? But we put some kind of filter, it becomes rectangular shape. This is the best lighting for the art. Mm. Art, you know.
So also, this kind of light is amazing because it's brought the potential of a cheap source of energy for communities all over the world that don't have access to light.
Yes.
And it's also bringing down energy bills.
Yes.
Because it's a more efficient use of light.
Yes, this is can be operated by battery, mobile lighting, cell phone, iPad, all kind of mobile device have to use this lighting to make displays. Mm. And also, most important, third country, there are no electricity, only available energy sources are sunlight.
Solar power.
So solar power charges the battery daytime, and nighttime we can operate LED lighting.
So you have solar power,
this
kind of device, and a battery with the blue LED giving the white light, and it's how much would that cost as a device?
I think now less than $10.
About $10.
Yes.
So a person could use that $10.
Yes.
With the source of solar power, and how long would that last for that person?
I think it's 3 years.
3 years.
Yes.
Wow. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Can I explain in this special situation of Japan electricity generation? Maybe you remember that in 2011, the big earthquake attacked Japan. Oh. So all the nuclear power plants stopped now. So the nuclear power plants supplied 30% of the electricity, but now it all stopped. So we have to adapt another way. So the LED is very important to reduce the energy consumption.
Mm-hmm. What the Nobel Prize said is that lighting accounts for about 20% of global energy use.
Yes.
Through the use of your white LED in time, that could come down to 5%. Mm-hmm. Not only do these light bulbs last 100 times as long as the incandescent bulb, they also contain no mercury. And one application also is the ultraviolet.
Yes.
Light can be used to clean polluted water.
Yes. Ultraviolet is used for basically to kill bacteria. Like Ebola virus, kill Ebola virus by that.
Ebola virus.
Yeah, Ebola virus, and also to pure water and purify the air. Basically, we can UV light. We can kill bacteria.
It's amazing. It kills bacteria.
Yeah.
Purify light and so on.
Yeah.
But Professor Nakamura, you had a very publicized fight with the corporation that was funding your research. You felt that you weren't properly remunerated for the research that you did to develop the blue LED. You were given, a bonus of $180?
Yes, sir.
And they went to, and you could potentially make millions and millions out of this invention.
Yes, basically, in 2000, I moved to the United States. So my Focom company started a lawsuit against me using an infringement of trade secret. So I became so angry about to my former company. So as a counter lawsuit, I started a lawsuit against my former company using Japanese patent law, Article 35. That one is even if I could invent something for company as an employee, patent right belong to me.
So the patent rights in Japan belong to the inventor,
not
the company that employs the inventor.
Yes.
That was lucky for you.
Yeah, if I have any agreement, no. So in my case, no agreement. So, but a court, court judge says, patent rights belong to the company, even if there are no agreement of document. But the judge also same time told me, you have a right to get the reasonable compensation fee.
I won't say what it is, but it was very reasonable, wasn't it?
Yeah, reasonable compensation fee.
Okay, yeah.
So,
but you were happy with it.
Yeah.
It made you a millionaire, a multimillionaire.
I settled by about $8 million. So,
$8 million, yeah. Not bad at all.
Yeah.
I mean, how do all of you feel around the table here that in terms of, intellectual property and patent rights and whether your inventions are used in the future in a way which is basically a money spinner? Do you feel that you should?
Well, we have a number of patents for our stuff. Most of them are infringed on left and right, and frankly, we don't care. You can either spend your time talking to lawyers all the time and be miserable, or you can get back in the lab and invent something else.
But you worked for your father's tool company. I mean, would he not have appreciated it if you'd invented some wonderful tools
For his company? Well, I did invent things for his company. They just sold poorly.
Stefan.
In my case, very unusual. I started out my scientific career with writing a patent in 1990. Before I had a postdoctoral job, and this turned out to be extremely helpful because at the later stage in my career, I ran out of support, institutional support, and so I used this patent and basically licensed it to a small company in Finland that gave me money, $100,000 in return, and I used this money in a very critical period to do my research. And that 9 months of research that was funded by the $100,000 really got me further.
I'm so glad to hear that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that was very forceful. So your patents can be
absolutely life-saving.
Yes. What about here? This, well, you can't really patent. Yours is just knowledge, isn't it?
That's
out there. Hard luck.
That's all right.
What about you two?
I think for us it's important to say that neuroscience is a big family, and we share a lot of both ideas and data. So from our lab, we put data on the internet so that other people can analyze it. And there are two reasons. One is that we give very good data. And the second thing is then we don't need that many animals, since we do animal research.
So we've got a question from the audience.
Yeah, my question relates to research in Africa. We know that huge successes have been made in the West. And in my opinion, there is a lack of collaboration with researchers in Africa, which has resulted to the outbreak of Ebola, for example. How could this be explained? And what threat does this pose to global health?
Okay, thank you. We'll take another question from the floor.
My question was a little bit related to his question. Is like in experimental science, because eyes are our main tool, how do you identify that sparkle that will turn into a fire? Because so many times researchers land on something, and then because they don't have enough elements to pack it up, sometimes they tend to just put it on the side. But how do you, what does it get to get the Nobel Prize? How do we identify it?
Well, all right, Eric Betzig, there are a few points there, you know, because...
I have opinions on all of them, but I don't want to take them everybody.
No, I mean, we'll just touch on it, but you're a very interesting story, because here you are, a Nobel laureate in chemistry, but I think in your own words you said, I was lousy at chemistry, yeah. I sucked at chemistry.
That was my exact words.
Yeah, and in fact, none of you is a chemist. And yet,
you are, sorry.
But you're head of the chemistry department, so I beg your pardon. Physical chemistry, but you're a physicist and you're more like a physicist. But anyway, with that.
The committee cited two specific papers for me to get the prize, and both of them happened while I was unemployed. So, in terms of the spark thing, I think what you want to do is you want to immerse yourself in problems and try to not sweep problems under the rug, but focus on problems and outstanding problems and try to put pieces of a puzzle together to solve these. And if a good scientist, I think, gets this monomaniacal focus on the problem, and you may not have all of the problems, but at least in my case, the solutions have come when I'm not directly looking at the problem, but through the subconscious mind. Either I was pushing my daughter around in a stroller or... So Poincaré talks about this in his book, about how you have to just starve your mind of everything except the problem, so the subconscious is forced to work on it. And then he was taking a vacation, stepping on a bus, and then all of a sudden he had this flash of insight. Mm. It's kind of... I have great confidence in my subconscious mind.
I've described you as a kind of reluctant chemist and how you were not good at chemistry at school, but you also had a bit of a kind of disdain for academia and, you know, life in the ivory tower. And in fact, you quit academia research and went to work for your family's tool business.
Right, right. So I still don't think I would ever be comfortable in a standard academic environment. In some ways, I've always just wanted to work at the bench, and in some ways the standard model seems to me an incredibly inefficient way to do research, because you train somebody to excel at bench science through their postdoc, and then you make an assistant professor out of them and rip that all away from them and stick them in an office and make an administrator out of them. I've been fortunate both at Bell Labs and then where I work now, they believe in allowing scientists be scientists and not administrators and people begging for grants. And so I can be in the lab and be more productive.
Stefan, we also had that question about you know, Ebola, for instance, and other viruses and so on, and we're told all the time now that antibiotics are not as effective as they used to be. Does your work in any way relate? How would you answer that question in the context of your work? Because before you can cure something, you have to understand it.
Exactly. And I think microscopes allow us better to understand what's going on, including the diseased cell. And of course, I think to some extent will also allow to understand much better how drugs work. And I can imagine that seeing things now at a cellular level will affect treating diseases substantially.
So in conclusion, all of you, do you think that the best science is useful science and all these budding Nobel laureates we have around us here? What's your final word of advice to them? Okay, Edward.
Yeah, I want to get back to the question of basic science. I really think it's so important that we also spend efforts on understanding things where we don't know what it will be useful for, because and especially perhaps I see that in neuroscience. I mean, you don't understand the brain enough to know actually what is useful, but I think as we get more knowledge about how the brain works, I know that it will be important for the whole range of psychiatry, neurology, and so on.
Mm. And for us.
Professor Myrna?
But there's many ways in which these two ideas are intermingled. Absolutely, I agree that basic science is very important, but sometimes basic science can be driven by some technological need. And there's many examples of where a technology has something new that needs to be invented, and that sort of gets people's mind thinking, I can come up with an idea that might make that work. And then new science comes out of the ability of that new method to see new things. The original single molecule work came from work at IBM on exploring an optical storage scheme and the fundamental limits of a completely different optical storage scheme, completely out in left field. And we saw single molecules as a result, and then that blossomed into, you know, applications in biology. You just have to have both, but you have to have some interplay between them and stable, continued funding for the basic science.
Professor Tyrrell, what about your advice to budding Nobel scientists, because, I mean, and economists, because you're a real superstar now in France. Wherever you go, you're stopped, you know, photographs and written, and we know the Prime Minister, Manuel Valls, said that this was a poke in the eye to all those people who were being anti-French, Gallic bashing and so on. Are you happy being a French hero?
It's very nice to, I mean, there's a lot of pride in my country about this. You know, I had a concert in my honor by Togan Sokiev, and then there was a big banner on the city hall for my city, you know, 12 meters by 15.
Wow.
On the city hall for 2 weeks, and people stopped me in the street. But in the end, you know, it's flattering, but the thing I want to do is to go back to my lab and
just carry on with your work. The Japanese media have been really huge in their presence in Stockholm, right. With three Japanese Nobel laureates. I mean, you're superstars, aren't you? Although you, Professor Nakamura, I mean, you said, you know, your battle with the Japanese corporation, you left in disgust and went to the United States because you felt that you could develop your work better there. But how do you feel? Pulled in two directions, Japan is claiming you as one of their great stars.
I don't know, but I became boring in Japan, so that's the reason I moved to the United States to challenge new things. Always as a scientist, I have to do new things, you know, new challenge. So that's the reason I moved to the United States. Now I'm a U.S. citizen. I have a U.S. citizenship. So after finding Japanese people finding my U.S. citizenship, they become a little bit angry. So now I'm a Nobel laureate for United States, not Japan. So.
Oh my goodness. Professor Amano, what do you think about what your colleague, Professor Nakamura, said there? Is it Nobel Prize for the United States or
Yeah. But I have a little bit different opinion. In my case, it's like engineering science. And in my part, the most important thing is to imagine the future system, or imagine the future. For example, the Microsoft Bill Gates, like, so it's like invention oriented. Of course, I understand that the fundamental basic study is very important, but for us, the most important thing, so basic study is which direction should we go? So, okay.
All right, Stefan Hill.
I think it's best to concentrate on problems that seem to be very difficult to solve. I think those problems are the most interesting problems, the most rewarding problems. But there's, of course, a risk in tackling such problems. And therefore, I think we have to embrace not only taking risk, but also we have to embrace the failures, especially also honor those people who try hard, do their best, but fail.
But don't start with, this is a problem in the world, I want to fix it.
That may be like that, but sometimes you get an idea of what you want to do, and that comes out of the blue. Mm-hmm. And with intuition, of course. And usually, if you do it out of intuition, you do it with passion, and then you have to be passionate about what you do.
My Brit.
No, it is about passion, and you need a vision. So you want to have a burning question. And if you have a burning question, whether it's microscopes or LEDs or economy or neuroscience, then that is the star that is leading you forward. And then you don't care about methods or if you have a salary or whatever you have, because it's so burning, you can't stop.
Is it a passion or an obsession?
Obsession also.
You're a psychologist, you should know all about obsessions and so on. Eric Betzig, what would your advice be to the potential Nobel
Well, it's just been said, passion. A lot of times I see kids in high school or college who are in science, who are in some ways pushed into science, and sometimes their motivations are to please their parents or something else. And if you would rather be a rap star or rather be a painter or rather be something else, just follow your passion, because in the end, the purpose of the passion is to get you past the failures and to get you so that you work hard. Because every field of endeavor, it comes down in the end to hard work. And hard work is kind of like compound interest in a bank. If you work 10% harder than the other guy, it actually multiplies year by year until all of a sudden your experience is twice or triple the other guy, and then you can excel in your field.
And then you win a Nobel Prize.
Well, who cares about
if you're
that?
Lucky. If
who
you're
cares
lucky.
About that?
So, you heard it here, folks. Passion, I'm all for passion. That's the end of this exclusive programme with this year's Nobel Laureates. We've looked into the minds of some of the greatest brains working currently in their fields. That's all from the Concert Hall here in Stockholm. Thank you to our audience here, family and friends of the Laureates, as well as students from all over Sweden. Thank you to you, wherever you are watching this, from me, Zeinab Badawi. Goodbye.